Fred Bronstein, Dean of the Peabody Institute, and today is Founders Day. 158 years ago, George Peabody established the Peabody Institute, the oldest conservatory in the United States today. Peabody's history is truly remarkable. It's an extraordinary legacy. One can't help but feel that in every step taken daily walking through the halls of this building. So when I first learned about Amit Peled's brilliant idea to do this concert, it was so striking to me. What better way to demonstrate the richness of Peabody's history than through this concert? 100 years ago on Founders Day, Pablo Casals played the program that Amit recreates this evening. What makes it, of course, even more extraordinary is he performs his program on the maestro's cello. Now, the fact that he's able to play on Pablo Casals' cello is due to Marta Casals Istemann, the widow of Pablo Casals, and herself a force in the music world. She has entrusted Amit to be the artist who would reintroduce this historic instrument to the music world. And it's an honor to be able to say she will be joining us this evening. She is delayed, but she will be joining us. Finally, a few months ago, President Daniels asked me about the highlights of the Peabody concert season, of which there are many, but my thoughts went immediately to this evening because of its historical significance. When he heard about this, President Daniels went to considerable length to rearrange his travel schedule to be here with us. And Ron, we're so glad you're here. Please welcome President Ron Daniels.
Thank you, Dean Bronson. Boy, that sounds so good. Founders Day, the gifted soloist, a revered instrument tied to an artistic legend, a complex moving Bach suite, a storied institution at Johns Hopkins. These are the elements of a momentous occasion in which a grand history, artistic excellence, and joyous music coalesce to move our spirits and inspire our minds. But this is not only a moment of grandeur. It's an evening that explores the intimate connection between musician and instrument, an interplay that elevates both, and indeed all of us, to something extraordinary. Amit tells a story about the Casals cello that evokes such a connection. Knowing the cello as intimately as he does, he described two places where the varnish had been worn away. These are where Casals' knee and chest rubbed the instrument when he played. Instrument and performer were so much a part of one another that they leave marks on each other. This is the evocative image that speaks to the magic that is about to unfold on this stage. It also captures the essence of the relationship between Peabody and Johns Hopkins. With its remarkable legacy, Peabody has become a crucial part of the university, leaving its mark on us and then the city that we call home. From the classic strings that Phil Friedberg called to the jazz riffs that ricochet off the walls of the Hopkins Club, Peabody's artists help us to explore our greatest fears, revel in our joys, and illuminate our common humanity. Forging new partnerships with divisions across our university and bringing music into East Baltimore's Henderson Hopkins School, they help us launch new academic programs and inspire future generations with the power of music. And this the Institute does with remarkable grace under its new dean, Fred Bronstein. And I'm just so glad, again, Fred, to be sharing the stage here with you this evening. And Peabody has served as a beacon to the century's most significant musicians, from Casals to Stravinsky, Leonard Bernstein, to Jesse Norman, and of course, Peabody's own Leon Fleischer, enriching the cultural landscape of Baltimore. Like artists with their instruments, together we are greater than the sum of our parts, complementing one another in our common goal to impact our world for the better. I hope that you enjoy this evening, and thank you for being here for this really unique celebration. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. kibbutz, small place in Israel, I started to play the cello, and I started to play the cello because of a girl who played cello. I was 10, and she was 14. The problem in that age is that you don't dare to talk to girls that are 4 years older than you. So I had a plan. And the plan was to take up the cello like her, and everything was planned up to our wedding. I thought that I will take lessons with her, we'll play duet together, she'll have to talk to me, and then we'll get married. But nothing of it happened. Besides the fact that I got stuck with this piece of wood forever. But while, when I started to play, my parents gave me a small tape cassette as a present. Even though they're not musicians, they always supported me. And on that tape cassette were pieces of Pablo Casals, short pieces, some of which I'm going to play right now. And I remember how I used to fall asleep with this tape cassette every night. And while I realized that the girl is gone, my love to the cello became so strong. And it was because of this cello, because of the sound that came out from this cello. Of course, growing up in this agriculture area in Israel, in the middle of nowhere, I couldn't even dream that one day I'll be able to hold this instrument and sort of be an ambassador to share it with you and with so many people around the world. Since I got it in September, I think Pablo, as I would like to call him, Pablo and I have been literally all over the world. We were in Turkey and in Russia, in Israel, in Germany, all over the States. And it's so wonderful to see so many people get excited about the legacy of Pablo Casals. One of the things I learned from Casals is not just how great it is for me to play his cello, is what he played in concerts. And this is an example, this program. He played recitals to entertain people. And somehow along the way, I realized that we, the performers, forgot about the entertainment part. And we started making those marathon, trying to prove to us and to very few people with usually white hair in the public that we can do it. It used to be fun. It used to be entertainment, which means one big piece, which is like a steak in a meal, one aperitif, like the Handel, and second half, just desserts. We like that, and you know when you go to a restaurant, if you eat three steaks, you just feel so full and so bad. But when you have desserts after one steak, you just feel good. So there's no shame in playing desserts. And that's what we're doing. Not only that, he was a pioneer. When he came to this school in 1915, and he played the three pieces by Fauré that I'm about to play with Noreen, those pieces were not known here. This was modern music. As hard as it is to understand. Fauré was his buddy, one of his best friends. They lived in Paris together. And I'm assuming, since tours were usually 3, 4, even 6 months, you take a boat and you come back when you come back. I'm assuming Fauré just told him, hey, buddy, can you please promote my music in the US? There are no recordings. So he played not only one, three pieces by Fauré that probably nobody heard here back then. And not to mention the Bach suite. The Bach were usually just etudes for some cellists. Some cellists didn't even play. So he came here and in one concert, he played a Bach suite for people that never heard that. And even if they did, they thought this is just etude. And in the second half, he was promoting his friend. I think it's really cool. So enjoy the rest of the meal with the desserts.
Thank you. Thank you.
little baby, one of my students found this program in the archive and gave it to me. And all I wanted to do is to share it with my students and sort of with the Peabody community, but it became such a monster event. And sometimes it's hard to remember that we are musicians and we have to take care of music and not just interviews and this and that. I know it's important. But I've said so many times to so many newspapers what I think about this program. And I would like to have the chance now to hear what you think about this program. Not only that, if you're not too shy, if you have any questions that you want to ask me or Noreen, she's very shy but she can talk. Oh! So, since this. Yes? I don't know, but I can play encore. What? Any other questions you have? Not just about the program. Yes.
Could you tell us what was done to restore the cello?
Yes. So the cello, as you know, was made in 1733, and Pablo Casals bought it in 1913, sorry. And he played on it all through his career until 1973 when he died. The last footage that we have with him playing this cello is from the United Nations when he was 95 years old and he got the Peace Award. And he played this cello on that event. It was his beloved cello. Inside it says Bergonzi, even though we know it's a Goffriller. And he used to call it all his life, my beloved Bergonzi. But it's a Goffriller. The cello, when I got it, was in a case for many years and was sort of like an old person just resting. And it was very hard to wake it up, and I'm lucky, I don't know if Mrs. Casals is here, but probably not, so I can tell you the story. I called her and I said that, sort of using my Israeli chutzpah, but I said that the cello is a great honor, but it doesn't really sound. It has great colors, but it's not open enough. And would you consider restoring it? And the main problem was that the neck of the cello sank for 10 millimeters through the years, since the belly of the cello went inside. So therefore the bridge, the last bridge that was on this cello was 10 millimeters too low. And that makes the sound too muted to play in big holes. So we needed to lift the neck, or I should say to make a new neck, which is a common thing to do probably once in 100 years. Make a new neck, and that's what they did. But the restorer said that once you open this instrument, you're going to find a lot of things. And it's not going to be just the neck, just to warn us. And so it was. They opened the cello, and the entire back was full of wormholes. Without the worms, they were vanished already. But there were a lot of tunnels in the wood, and that makes the wood weak. And if the wood is weak, it cannot observe the vibration as much as we want. So they had to put layers of wood here to reinforce the back of the cello. As you can see, this is from sweat, but this is Casals' knee. Another question? Yes.
Was playing two contemporary pieces pretty typical for Casals' programming and his own music?
Yes, it was typical, not only to play his friend's music, but his own music. He wrote a lot of pieces for cello. Popper, at the same time, wrote many pieces for cello and played mostly his pieces. It was unheard of in those days, and prior to those days, to play a whole sonata. When Beethoven wrote his sonata, it was not intended for us to play them through. God forbid if somebody clapped today between movements. We think they don't understand the music. But these pieces were never performed like this. This was sort of for the living room to play for one another. In concert, it's a show, and you entertain people. If you look at programs of Liszt from even earlier, it was a big party. He would invite a singer to sing one lead, then he would improvise on a theme by Wagner, then he would play his own music, then there'd be a trio, and people could talk in between pieces. And if somebody coughed, his wife didn't hang. So I guess we will play an encore. Maybe until we get the music, I would like to, it will take just 2 minutes, to share with you a little quote by Pablo Casals that really affected me both as a parent, as a teacher, and just as a human being. So just before the encore, here is a little quote that will be important for all of us to hear and to realize how great was this man, not just as a cellist, not just as a musician, as a humanitarian. Every second we live is a new and unique moment for the universe, a moment that never was before and will never be again. And what do we teach children in school? We teach them that 2 and 2 make 4, and that Paris is the capital of France. When will we also teach them, do you know what you are? You are a marvel. You are unique. On all of the world, there is no other child exactly like you. On the millions of years that have passed, there has never been another child like you. And look at your body, what a wonder it is. Your legs, your arms, your cunning fingers, the way you move. You may become a Shakespeare, a Michelangelo, a Beethoven. You have the capacity for anything. Yes, you are a marvel. And when you grow up, can you then harm another who is like you, a marvel? You must cherish one another. You must work. We all must work to make this world worth of children. Pablo Casals.